that it's going to be, you may be a little nervous when I start to joke out, but it's going to be all right. All right. My pastor friend, Steve McIntosh, shared this joke with me. And so if you want to get mad, I'll give you his information and you can contact him and deal with it. But I thought it was absolutely hilarious. That was a reminder to say the joke. There was this country church in out in the country, and this guy walks in with his guitar, and he said, I'd like to play a song for you guys. Is that okay? He said, boy, we would love that. We would love you to get up and play a song. So he gets up, takes his guitar out of the case. Ching, I feel like hell. They're going. Ching, I feel like hell. And they're going. Everyone's looking at each other. All of a sudden, ching, I feel like helping people to see Jesus. I thought that was funny. That's like editing. The editing crew has kicked in. Amen. Amen. Praise God. We're going to start here. I've kind of overall titled this, The Many Faces of Grace. It's a good one, ain't it, Mark? But more specifically today, I want to talk about why people fail or to appropriate or receive grace, why they don't receive grace. Amen? And there's a lot of people in the body of Christ that are born again, but they're not receiving grace. And there's some reasons for that. And let me just start with Hebrews chapter 12. I'm going to say Hebrews chapter 12. And we'll start with verse 14. And then I want to be in Romans chapter 5, verse 17. But I just want to show you this. It says, follow peace with all men. In other words, pursue peace with all men. Romans 12 says, as much as it lies within you, live peaceably with all men. In other words, try to get along. Some people you can't. All right. Yeah. But you do the best you can. And holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Now, we've talked about this before. I want to say it again. This isn't saying that if I don't live holy, I won't see the Lord. This is saying that if holiness is not a reality in my life, in other words, consecration or separation to God, if it's not a fruit in my life, according to Romans 6:22, nobody's going to see the Lord. No man will see the Lord through me. Amen. You know, you've heard people say you're the only Jesus that some people will see. That's very true. And if I live totally carnal and sense-led and, you know, I act like the world and I'm, you know, cussing people out and doing all those things, no one will see the Lord through me. Amen? That's what he's saying. He's not talking about you're seeing the Lord. And next verse, that's not really what I'm after. I just wanted to mention that. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. In other words, give me this out of the Amplified, if you don't mind. I want to show you this. Amplified. Exercise foresight and be on the watch to look after one another, to see that no one falls back from and fails to secure God's grace, his unmerited favor and spiritual blessing. And of course, it goes on. But here's what I'm saying. No one falls back from and fails to secure God's grace. Now, if that wasn't possible as a believer, that I can fail to secure God's grace, then the Lord would have never had that put in the Word of God. Amen? Here's my point. We can fail to receive God's grace. And there's reasons for that. Amen? One amen. Thank you. You should have seen Wayne Sheriff. He was so funny. He goes, well, this isn't going as good as I thought. Anyhow, he's a hoot. But anyhow, you can fail to secure God's grace. There's huge reasons for it. Go to Romans 5:17. Familiar verses of scripture, but I really want to lay the foundation. And we're going to talk about what that is, what that looks like, et cetera, et cetera. Romans 5:17. I'll just take it out of the King Jimmy. King Jimmy, for if by one man's offense, and that one man's offense, that's referring to Adam. By one man's offense, Adam's. Death reigned by one. In other words, death reigned because of Adam's transgression. All the death and the destruction and the things you see in this world are because of Adam's fall. That's why when you get to heaven and you want to know where Adam's at, it's going to be heavily secured, you know, guards by... No, I'm kidding. For if by one man's offense, death reigned by one. In other words, it's referring to Adam. Much more, but he say much more. They which receive... Now, this is powerful. In the Greek, this is in the present tense. Those who are receiving on a consistent basis. Amen? You have to receive something consistently. It needs to be a lifestyle of reception. Amen? A lifestyle of receiving. A lifestyle of receiving. Notice what we're receiving. Much more. I love the much more, don't you? Much more. They which are receiving the abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. In other words, just the way, think about this. You know, we see all the destruction in the world, right? We see all the negative things in the world. But it says much more. Those who are receiving the abundance of grace. That means lots of grace. Abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness. They shall reign in life by one Christ Jesus. Amen? So I think it's important. See, the reason people don't give mercy and grace and those types of things to other people is because they're not receiving it for themselves. Amen. You only give away what you're receiving yourself. Isn't that powerful? That's simple, but that's powerful. Now, there's reasons why people don't receive God's grace. Go to Matthew chapter 13 and verse 19. Matthew chapter 13 and verse 19. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and understands it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. This is Matthew's account of the parable of the sower. Notice when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and doesn't understand it. And doesn't understand it. Satan's able to steal that right out of their heart. Isn't that amazing? The number one reason people don't receive grace is they don't understand it. Amen? And I'm going to talk about not just what people don't understand. And I'm going to prove to you. I'm going to do a few little tests on you. That we don't know near as much as we think we know. I don't say that in a condescending way. I say that in a humble way. Because that's good news. I've discovered that if I'm the problem, that's good news. If God's the problem, we got problems. Amen? Because He's the Lord and He changes not. But see, I can change this. The number one reason people don't receive God's grace is they don't understand it. And understanding is something you have to grow in. I continually get enlightened in this area. I continually think people are further along in their understanding, and I find out, I'm amazed, myself included. Amen? This isn't a me, and this is all of us. But it's good news. Go to Galatians chapter 1, verse 6. Galatians chapter 1, verse 6, before we get to the test. Now, who's heard the terminology, the gospel of grace? Who's heard that? Let me see your hands. Who's heard that? We all, the gospel of grace. And that's not wrong. I had subscribed to that myself, the gospel of grace. But the gospel is grace. There's no such thing as a graceless gospel. If you remove grace, it's not gospel. Well, they don't deserve grace. Then it's not grace. All right? I want to show you that. Here's something we need to understand. When you say gospel, it has to be grace. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. Notice he's synonymous with gospel and grace. Now, here's my first test. I'm going to say something. Don't raise your hands. Don't even bat an eye. But how many of you think that grace cover sin? Good question. How many of you people believe, don't raise your hands, don't do anything, that grace covers sin? Grace does not cover sin. There's not one scripture in the Bible that says grace covers sin. Woo. Well, then what covers sin? 1 Peter chapter 4, we'll begin with verse 7. See, this is what people don't understand. Just like the statement I just made. I'll show you what covers sin, and then we'll show you what grace does. We'll define it too, by the way. When we show you what it does, we'll define it. Grace does not cover sin. There's not one scripture in the Bible that says grace covers sin. Not one. But yet people believe that. Well, I'm just doing, man, grace covers sin. No. Watch this. But the end of all things is at hand. Be therefore sober and watch unto prayer. Next verse. And above all things have fervent charity. Now watch this. Fervent charity is love. Agape. Intense love. The love of God. Among yourselves. For charity, or God's kind of love, covers a multitude of sins. Love covers sins, not grace. There's a difference. Well, then what does grace do? See, if you don't understand what grace is, you won't know what grace does. Grace breaks the dominion of sin. See, if you think grace is just unmerited favor, as great as that is, and it is unmerited favor, grace breaks the dominion of sin. And I won't go there, but I will quote it, and I'll give you the verse. Romans 6:14 says, sin shall have no dominion over you, for you're not under law, but you're under grace. See, grace is God's enabling power, God's ability, all of God's blessings, all that God has given to us on an unearned, undeserved basis. I'm going to prove that from the Bible. Well, my favorite teacher says it's unmerited favor only. No, it's not. It is unmerited favor. It is. Please don't misunderstand me. But it's God's ability. God's ability given to us on an unearned, undeserved basis. That's big, because if you think grace covers sin, you're going to miss it. Love covers sin. Let me read on here. And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Next verse. Use hospitality one to another without grudging. Next verse. As every man has received the gift. Well, this is big. As you've received the gift, even so minister the same one to another. So in other words, as I receive, I minister to you. Watch this. As good stewards of the manifold grace of God. That's why I call it the many faces of grace. Grace is manifold. That means it's varied. There's many, many operations of grace. Amen. See, but if you don't understand this, you won't receive it. If you don't understand that you've got enough money in your checking account to pay off a particular bill, it'll hinder how you function in paying that bill off. Amen? Amen. This is big, man. This is big, big. As every man has received the gift, even so minister the same one to another. As good stewards. What is a steward? A steward is a manager, a household manager. As good stewards of the manifold, or the varied, the multifaceted grace of God. Amen. Say amen. That's good news. That means there's grace for every single situation in your life. There's power in every situation. That's my phone. There's power in every single situation. For every situation you come up against, God's got grace for you. Glory to God. Somebody say amen. Amen. That's good news. God's got ability that's been given to you on an unearned, undeserved basis. One more verse. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God, or in other words, God's words. If any man minister, let him do it with as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Jump over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 10. Watch this. Verse 9. We'll start with verse 9. For I am the least of the apostles, this is Paul talking, that am not meet or fit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. Next verse. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. Now, once again, what is grace? I wrote down some definitions. Grace is God's love in action. Grace is God's love in action. Grace is God's ability given to us on an unearned, undeserved basis. I wrote down a few more. Grace is God's benefits bestowed upon the believer because of his favor upon that person. God's benefits. All of God's benefits. Isn't that good news? See, but Paul says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God, which is with me. Do you see what, see, was grace empowering the Apostle Paul, yes or no? I hear a few whispered yeses. Was grace empowering the Apostle Paul? He said, by God's grace, I labored more abundantly than everybody else. By God's grace on my life, I labored more abundantly than everybody else. That's why Peter says it's the manifold or the multifaceted grace of God. Amen? God's grace for every situation is available in our life. Did you know that? Every situation that you come up against, God's got a grace to meet that situation. Isn't that good news? I think that's awesome news. God's got a grace for every single situation. But if you don't understand grace, you won't appropriate grace. Now, this leads me to my next point. Another area that people don't understand is they don't understand faith. And we've talked about this before, but I'm going to reiterate it. Faith does not earn anything from God. God has provided everything by grace. Every need that we have has been taken care of under God's grace. Did you know that? Everything. But it's appropriated by faith. This is why there's such an attack on faith. Did you know that? Because faith appropriates what's already been provided by grace. Faith receives what's already been provided by grace. Faith is my positive response to what God has already provided by grace. But if I don't understand faith, because I don't understand grace, guess what? I won't receive it. See, this is why understanding is so huge. Because the enemy preys on ignorance. You know why there's deception in the body of Christ and outside the body? Because of ignorance. Do you know that the majority, if not all, the epistles were wrote to correct error? Did you know that? Did you know that? Oh, I'm saved. I'm just floating along. That's exactly what the enemy wants you to believe. You can float along and float right to heaven. If you're born again, you're going to heaven. But how many of you know God's called us to live victoriously? And if I'm to live victoriously, I must be receiving the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness if I'm to reign in life by Jesus Christ. Amen? If I'm not receiving, see, if your receiving is cut off, then your giving is cut off. You can't give away what you're not receiving. Praise the Lord. That's simple. Notice he says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And it was not bestowed on me in vain. But see, the attack on faith is the attack on my ability to receive God's grace. Now go to 1 Timothy chapter 1. Watch this. Man, I've been meditating. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 19 and 20. Watch these verses. See, if I don't understand grace, I won't understand faith. See, this is there's people teaching now that God's done everything by grace, and because he's done everything by grace, you have no part in it. Wrong. Wrong. That teaching is destroying lives. destroying Christian lives because they say, hey, God did everything, so it doesn't matter how I live. It doesn't matter if I go to church. It doesn't matter if I'm a giver. It doesn't matter. None of this matters anymore because it's all done by grace. You don't understand. It does matter. Amen. You know, we said it before. We said it a couple weeks ago. When you form your habits will form you. And if you're forming habits of not responding to the grace of God, which is called faith, you won't receive the grace of God. And if you don't receive the grace of God, you will operate like somebody who's not even born again. It's called carnal Christians. There's a lot of Christians like that. Now watch this. Holding faith in a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck. Now watch, notice what it says. Holding to faith, echo in Greek, which means to hold fast to. Holding to faith and a good conscience. What's a good conscience? Before, I'm going to say one thing about a good conscience and we'll come right back here. Jump over to Hebrews 9:14 and we'll come right back here. Look at this. I've said this before, but it's just rock and roll. How much more shall the blood of Christ, he's talking about the blood of bulls and goats under the old covenant, who through the eternal spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience, not from sin, but from dead works, to serve the living God. There's a couple things here. God, our conscience are purged by the blood of Christ from dead works to serve. Notice we are to serve, but it's how we serve that matters. You know, people are created to do. You know, people get frustrated when they can't do anything. Did you know that? I like to say Adam had a job in the garden before the fall to tend the garden. We were created to do. It's in us. But see, so people, they get, well, I want to please God, so they start doing things to please God, and that's wrong. God's already pleased because of Jesus. But see, when your conscience is purged, that you're no longer doing things to try to earn anything from God, by the blood of Jesus, and you begin to understand that, you serve. Amen? Does that make any sense? So service is not in question. But back to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 19. Watch this. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 19. I love this stuff. Holding faith and a good conscience, with some having put away or thrust away or repelled away concerning faith, have made shipwreck. Notice there's not one mention of grace here. You notice that? You see, grace is God's part, and it's a done deal. Faith is something that God has given us to appropriate grace. But notice if faith can be messed up and your conscience can be messed up. Like I used to believe, the seven steps to faith. And if I did this, God would move. Are you hearing me? If I did this, God would move. I'll say that again. No, God's already moved by grace. So if I think that I'm doing something to get God to move, I'm messed up. That's why I say, holding faith and a good conscience. We just talked about a good conscience. A conscience that's purged from religious dead works. Now he can serve the living God. Golly, this is powerful. I hope you're hearing it. I'm maintaining a slow posture, even though I'm wanting to take off. All right? Watch this. Holding faith and a good conscience, which some having thrust away, repelled away concerning faith, have made shipwreck. Now, these people are born again. I'll say that again. These people are born again. They wouldn't be in faith if they wasn't born again. I'll say that again. They would not be in faith if they wasn't born again. Next verse. Of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander? Little nugget here. Hymenaeus has to do with, his name means belonging to marriage. Alexander's name means man defender. That's on the CD. You meditate on it. You know, belonging to marriage, we're the bride of Christ. Amen. But when you make it when you become a man defender, you're a mess. And it's just a little nugget. Of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto the PTA club. I delivered to the nursery. I put them under the jurisdiction of Satan. That is strong, bro. I said, Paul, let's sit down. We need to talk about this. You're getting a little worked up here. whom I have delivered unto Satan that they might learn. They got to learn not to blaspheme. Notice, I delivered them unto Satan so they'd go to hell. No. That they might learn not to blaspheme. Wow. Now back to verse 19. Holding faith and a good conscience, which some, having put away concerning faith, have made shipwreck. See, if you don't understand the balance of grace and faith, you'll be a mess. Amen? You'll be a mess. And you won't know how to appropriate. You will step outside of your measure of grace. Do you know we all have a measure of grace? See, because people don't understand grace and they don't understand faith, that leads them to step outside their measure of faith. I'm going to talk to you about measure now, or your measure of grace. I'm sorry. You have a measure of grace. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. Watch this. You're getting ready to get some revelation. That's something that bugged me for years. Anybody ever had anything from the Bible bug them? Nobody? I'm the only one. Well, try to relate to me. But you know, in time, when I'm able to hear it, God begins to show it to me. Watch this. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. In other words, you have a grace, I have a grace. A lot of people, even in which we try to do things that are outside of our measure of grace. Amen? Do you know, I know this. I am called to be a husband. I have grace to be a husband. You see, some people think, well, that's not a big deal. It is a big deal. Try being a husband without grace. Anybody ever done that? No, nobody, okay. I have to understand that. I have a grace for what I'm called to do. Sometimes I wonder why I think like the way I think, because that's how God made me. Same with you. I think a certain way because of that. That's how God's made me. But I recognize that I'm not the only one that has a grace, that I need your grace. Are you hearing me? See, we think like, well, this is who I am, bless God, this is me, and everybody's got to think like me. No, we're the body. We need each other. See, that's what this, if you don't understand grace and how grace works within a measure, and we're going to see as we read on down here, and how I need your measure, you need my measure, we need each other's measure, right? If we don't understand that, we will operate independently, thinking we're an island. Nobody is an island. I'm going to say this in our tech age, we still need the body of Christ. Amen. We need the church. We need each other. In all of our imperfections, we need each other. But anyhow, but unto everyone, say everyone. Are you an everyone? Okay. Is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Next verse. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, referring to Jesus, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Next verse. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? Next verse. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. Now watch this next verse. This next verse we've commonly referred to as the fivefold ministry. But I got a revelation here that rocked my world. Look at it. And he gave some. That doesn't mean all. He gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Stop. Now, when you think of an evangelist, I'm going to take one example here. What do you think of? I'll tell you what I think of. I think of an evangelist as somebody that's reaching the lost, right? Amen. Right? He's reaching the lost. And he may be passing out tracts on the street. He's doing this. He's doing the work of an evangelist, as the scripture says. That's what I picture. But I got a problem with that. If an evangelist is reaching the lost, then look at the next verse. I'm confusing you good because we're going to answer it here in a minute. Look at this. Next verse. For the perfecting or the equipping, that word perfecting means equipping. Most translations say that. Of the saints. Now, wait a minute. An evangelist is to reach the lost, but here he's talking about these gifts for the saints, to equip the saints. Are you confused yet? What's up with that? For the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Now back to verse 11. Here's what an evangelist is. just like a prophet. We could pick on every one of these. Are you ready? I'm using an evangelist as an example. God's given that gift to the body. We're all called to do the work of an evangelist. Do you know that? But then an evangelist's gift to the body is a gift of someone who teaches the body how to evangelize. That's why it's given to the body. Just like we're all supposed to prophesy. Did you know that? But not everyone's a prophet. Okay, I'll show it to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 and we'll just do 14, verse 31. Watch this. 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 31. For ye may all prophesy. Word prophecy, and I'm not teaching on that right now, but it means to speak forth the mind of God. We all have grace to prophesy, to speak forth the mind of God. And it doesn't have to be in King James either. Okay? Are you hearing me? But the gift of a prophet is given to the body to equip the body in their ability to prophesy. The gift of an evangelist is a gift that's for the body to equip the body to do the work of an evangelist. You know, the servant of the Lord must be apt to teach, it says in 2 Timothy 2. That word apt to teach in the Old King James means skillful in teaching. God gave pastors, or the Greek literally says teaching pastors. Why? To teach the body to be able to teach other people. Are you hearing this? See, we all have grace to do these things as individuals. Just because you prophesy or bring forth a word or speak forth the mind of Christ in a situation does not mean you go out and get your cards printed up, prophet so-and-so. Amen. Oh, that blessed me. I don't know if it blessed you. Back to 1 Corinthians. Let me read that. Leave it right there. For you may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be comforted. Notice it's not giving direction. You're supposed to marry so-and-so. Knock that off. All right, back to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. And we're going down to verse 16. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. See, sometimes people, here's what I've discovered in my Christian walk, that whenever somebody gets fired up for the Lord and they're really fired up, they must be a pastor or they must be a traveling teacher. Not necessarily. You may just be called to help somebody, and it's all important. I'll give you an example. Do you know, raising kids, a woman who raises kids, do you know that's a big deal?
Amen.
Amen. Or a man, you know what I'm saying? We think, well, no, she's not working or he's not. Listen, that's work. That's a huge amount of work. But see, it takes a grace to do that. But see, some people have this mindset that, well, if they're not the head of the ministry, then they're not fulfilling their call. See, this is what I'm saying. God gave these gifts to equip the body for the work of the ministry. And we're going to see here that if everybody's flowing in their measure of grace, the body functions perfectly. But if everybody's not, the body does not. See, this isn't a thing like, well, I'm going to be the pastor so I can be the king and I can sit on the throne. Hogwash. If you think that's what pastoring is, have at it. I mean it, because it's not that. It's not that. It's serving. That's what true ministry, the word ministry just means serving. Amen. And I used to wonder why they had ministers' conferences and stuff like that. I'm thinking, all you guys do is talk a little bit. So, boy, have I got a wake-up call. Amen? And there's a lot of talk about, you know, some of you want to quit and you just don't quit. You know how many, like 22,000 pastors a month quit in the United States? Something like that. I could be wrong on that, but it's a bunch because it's hard. It takes grace to do it. The only thing that keeps me going is my excitement for the Word of God and you wonderful people. But I'm telling you, there's times where you think, what am I doing? Lots of times. And the devil loves that. So pray for your pastors. Pray for us. I mean that. Make mention of us in your prayers. I don't know why I got off on that. It must be the Lord. And he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. Next work. For the perfecting of the saints, the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry to build up the body of Christ. Next verse, I'm going to verse 16. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man. You know, the body of Christ is supposed to operate as a perfect man. That man is Christ. We're to operate as a unit, a single unit. Unto the measure, the stature, the fullness of Christ. Next verse. That we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. Boy, does that ever happen. He's talking to believers. This isn't for the world out there. And let me give you an example. I wrote this down. This is from Ed Elliott, so I'll give him credit here. Rebellion to the law isn't grace. I'm going to let that hang. There's a lot of eggheads in the body of Christ, and they're teaching it. They're teaching this attitude that, well, you're not under the law, so you rebellion. Rebellion against the law is not grace. It's called rebellion against the law. Sadly, some of these folks have been in rebellion to law, aka religion, and in their minds, they think what they have is grace. So in their minds, they've been rebellion, and that they think that's grace. That's why I said that statement earlier. How many people believe grace covers sin? Grace does not cover sin. Love does that. Grace breaks the dominion of sin. Romans 6:14. Titus chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. Grace breaks the dominion of sin. Amen. Well, Jesus broke the dominion. People are going around saying stuff like, I'm Jesus. You're not Jesus. Now it says, he that has joined in the Lord is one spirit. It says, as he is, so are we in this world. In the spirit, you are one with him, but you are not Jesus. It's Christ in me, Chris, the hope of glory. God does not obliterate your personality. But there's people because they, see, and it sounds good, and because they have a charisma and an ability to deliver, and they can speak and all these types of things, people are pulled into this mess. Amen. And you guys are so blessed. You really are. So am I. Amen. That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Boy, this is amazing. Every wind of doctrine. Every wind of doctrine. You know, can blow you here and blow you there. That's why I say there's something to be said for commitment and faithfulness. You know, that's what Paul said. God counted me faithful putting me in the ministry. Wow. Anyhow, he wasn't tossed to and fro. Next verse. Hallelujah. But speaking the truth in love may grow up. I get a kick out of Andrew. Pull your thumb out of your mouth and grow up. He says that all the time. I love it. He said, but so many people in the body. See, some people don't like this. Some people will say, well, this isn't grace, Chris. Every time we're challenged, that's not, this is grace. Grace will challenge me to come up hither. Amen? See, I'm going to give an example. The Bible talks about grace reigning through righteousness, Romans 5:21. And I married the most gorgeous woman in the world. Amen. And I know your wife is to you, but I love, and say we're not married. And how does grace reign? How does grace reign in my life? And say I see her and she's so gorgeous and I can acknowledge, she's a pretty woman and stuff like that. But say, like Brother Hagin used to say, she was easy to look at, right? But say it goes past just seeing a beautiful woman and I start to get into areas of lust. How does grace reign? Well, I'm under grace, bless God, and grace covers sin. No, grace reigns because I realize that that's not who I am. And because I understand that that's not who I am, that isn't the way I have to act. I have authority and power. See, I receive the grace of God, and it breaks the dominion of that. Amen? But see, so many times we want to indulge our emotions, and like a wild horse out of control, once it's out of control, we try to rein it in, and it's pretty hard to do. But if you nip it in the bud right at the beginning, you can deal with it. Are you hearing me? And by the way, I don't need a ride home now. Some of you got that. Some of you'll get it later. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. God wants us to grow up in him in all things. Next verse. from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted. The whole body. Everybody say the whole body. Fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies. We're all a part of the body. Every joint supplies. Every joint supplies. Not just one joint, but every joint supplies. Watch this. According to the effectual working or the effective working in the measure of every part. Measure of what? Verse 7, the measure of grace. According to the working of God's grace in every single part. This is what causes the body to work together and to function together. Amen? Makes increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. See how it's supposed to work? But the reason that people many times fail to receive grace is, number one, they don't understand grace. And because they don't understand grace, they don't understand faith. Romans chapter 12, verse 3 says, to every man is dealt a measure of faith. If you read that in context, the next verse he starts talking about ministry gifts. He starts talking about gifts in the body, right? What is the measure of faith? The measure of faith is connected to your measure of grace that appropriates the grace he's given you to fulfill what he's called you to do. Amen? See, if you don't understand grace and you don't understand faith, you'll fail to receive God's grace and you'll step outside of your measure. This is why people are frustrated. They're trying to do things that God hasn't equipped them to do. Or they're not doing things that God has equipped them to do. Are you hearing that? Now, faith without works, they're not doing things that God has equipped them to do. And so they're frustrated. I don't want to live a frustrated life. I have this desire that I want to fulfill everything that God has called me to do. I really do. And you know, you think, oh, that's easy, man. No, there's a fight. That's why it's called the good fight of faith, or 1 Timothy 6:12. Because if you get messed up, you will not receive the grace, and you'll be outside of the measure of where God's called you to function. Amen? I don't have time to go there, but I'll just give you the reference in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 12, all the way down to the end of the chapter, verse 18. He's talking about stepping outside of your measure of what God has equipped you to do. And we don't want to do that. This is why people, in that same context, verse 12, 2 Corinthians 10, they compare themselves among one another. I was listening to Pastor Dwayne. He's so funny. And he was saying, he goes, you think this isn't real? He says, you ought to go be around ministers. They always say, how many are you running? That's the first question. And Dwayne goes, you got to know how he talks to us. I go, running in or running out? Because there's people running out that just like they're running in. Sometimes there's more run out than they run in. It's the same everywhere, people. See, the more you get settled in your relationship with God, the more you understand that, man, I have everything right here, right now. Amen? Amen? And I just try to constantly hear more and more. Whoops, that's off. He loves us. Amen? I'm going to end. I'm landing the plane. Hallelujah. Oh, it's still clicking there. Praise God. Are we blessed or what? Say, I am blessed. Highly favored. I'm deeply loved. Amen. If there's anybody here that does not know Jesus, you've never been born again, I want to give you that opportunity because that's an awesome opportunity. Amen. Anybody? Nobody. Another thing that I want to be getting into is I want to start looking at all the different facets of grace. And obviously we won't cover them all, but there's just different things that the scripture says that grace enables you to do. And it's awesome. But if there's anybody here and you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues and you'd like to be, you talk about a grace. That is awesome. I shared with some people. I was out and I was at the Greenville Federal branch in Kroger store and I was standing there and I sat there and I thought, my, oh my, I feel like Superman. I'm serious. I felt like Superman. And I'll tell you why, because I was building myself up on my most holy faith. And sometimes when you do that, you don't feel anything the moment you're building yourself up. But later on down the road, I'm telling you, God, the power's in your spirit, big people. Did you hear what I said? The power's in your spirit. Some of us look like we got more of the spirit than others. No. But that's where it's at. And if you and I will tap into that, we can live in a state where God's, listen, we all have things come against us. But if you want to be built up, build yourself up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. It is awesome. And I want to encourage you that you guys that have it, do it every day, as much as you can. Set a time to prime the pump. Start with 10. I'm giving you an assignment. This will help you. It'll set you free. Give yourself an assignment. God's not mad if you don't do it. But it will help you step into the love of God. Keep yourself in the love of God. Start with 10, 15 minutes and just go out somewhere. I like to walk and sometimes a lot of times I like to sit in the car, but sometimes I'll just walk and pace. And so it's not a matter of how loud or how quiet. That's not the point. But let the river flow. Let it go where it wants to go. You'll hear some wild things come out of your mouth. I know I'm cut loose, but you need to hear this. I pray that the recording is still on. Do it. I don't believe I would be standing here if it wouldn't be for the prayer language of the Holy Ghost. I really don't. I really don't. I don't think I can keep going without it. Are you hearing me? I don't think any of us can keep going without operating from our spirit. Because flesh is, that's why people get all, they're frustrated, they're this, they're that. We all deal with things. But the whole, praying in the Holy Ghost, that's why I'm so thrilled with that Joseph Prince this month. He's back on praying in tongues. A grace preacher. Andrew Womack, I told him this week when I talked to him, he hammered it. He hammered it. I said, I love it. It's the key. I'm going to quote verbatim. Many of you respect Joseph Prince. I'm going to quote verbatim from him. Verbatim. Word for word. Tongues is the key to walking in the new covenant. I don't think I minced one word there. I'm doing this because I love you. See, people, pastors a lot of times, well, don't do anything that might offend people. If that offends you, you need to be offended. I'm serious. Don't you want to walk in victory? You know what walking in victory is? That doesn't mean everything in your life's perfect. If that's the case, the Apostle Paul certainly did not walk in victory. But that means you're walking with a power and a joy that's otherworldly. It's out of this world. You don't even understand it. It's a peace that passes understanding. And the key is the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the primary way, the number one way that it's released is through a language. Think about that. God gave you a whole language. Do you ever think about that? Go to the airport sometime and walk around. Say, I got a better language than that. You can fly right into it, man. It's awesome. Nobody even looks at you. I love it. Act serious. Amen? It's awesome. It's awesome. I love it. See, how many times have you ever started feeling down? Nobody? Build yourself up. Prime the pump. It may not come right away, but all of a sudden, that depression that was trying to keep you down, all of a sudden it'll break. Just like a dam. It's called breakthrough. And that life that's in your spirit will just wash it away. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God, there's a greater flood. Amen. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water, John chapter 7. You know the word rivers there? Potomac. It's translated floods in Matthew 7. Amen. It's also in Luke chapter 6. A torrent, a mighty torrent. Amen. Anybody need healing for anything? We are done. Anybody that you want prayer for? Okay.
I